Well, good morning. I'm Ms. Torres, and I know you guys have seen me in here helping out with worship every now and then, and I'm going to be sharing the message this morning. And I was really excited when Mrs. Mayer asked me to go ahead and to share a little bit of my story. And I just want to share with you right now that, you know what? All of the adults who are here are real people. They're authentic. They are transparent. They're trying to show you what God has done in their lives by how they act every day. And sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we aren't perfect. But we are someone, or we are a people that try our best to live out the love that God has given to us. Okay? So when we're going through times, you all are struggling with things, or it's just a happy day, we want to hear what's going on in your life. And that's why we choose to work in a Christian school, because we then have the opportunity to share what God's doing for us, and we also have an opportunity then to be praying for you and to be encouraging you. And so all of these adults here care about you, and that's why they choose to be here each and every day, because really, they love all of you. And that love comes directly from who loved them first. And I want to focus on this scripture, and then we're going to pray. But here in Romans, it says, "But in all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us." That means no matter what's going on in our life, we can conquer it because God loved us. "For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depths, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Let's pray. Lord, I just want to thank you for this time that we have here this morning in chapel, God. I just pray that the words that you've given me will be expressed in such a way that touches the hearts of everyone in here, God. And I pray that you'll just speak through me right now, Lord, and you'll give the message that you've planned for us to hear today in your name. Amen. All right, well, my condolences to all the Dodger fans. It was a rough weekend, I know. And I don't think I could stand up here and not say that. Now, after I say that, do you like babies? Well, okay. There's something about being a little baby when you're innocent and, well, maybe not completely innocent, you know, because we are selfish when we're born. We're not born perfect. We automatically need things from people. And when we don't get them, we cry about it. But doesn't this baby just look like the Gerber baby? Yeah, you ever seen the Gerber? That's me. All right. Aw. You can go aw. Aw. Yeah, yeah. True story, that ribbon is taped to my head because I didn't have long enough hair for there to be an actual bow, and my mom was convinced that people thought I looked like a little boy, and so she would tape ribbons to my hair, and she got my ears pierced at 6 weeks, and people still called me, "Oh, what a cute little boy," and "Oh, I got chubbier," and I think that's still taped on there. But, you know, there's something about a family, you know, when they have their first child, they dote over that child. They want to take lots of pictures. And usually the firstborn has the most pictures of them. Okay? Raise your hand if you're firstborn. All right. All right. So your parents, they haven't done this before, and so they're excited, and they want to go ahead and just show you off. And then the second one comes around, and maybe half the number of pictures are taken. Oh, not even close. We got testimonies up here. And then if you're a third, fourth, fifth, well, you're lucky if you got your kindergarten picture, okay? But I was a firstborn, and here's my family now. This is, my parents are in the middle, Gil and Eva. My father's a pastor, and my mom, she's a missionary, and she works with women all over the state of California, overseas a lot, doing mission trips. My brother, who's sitting down next to me, Josh, he's a pastor in Riverside, and he planted a church about 7 years ago. And his wife is standing next to him. That's Erica. And her father's a pastor. And her sister and brother-in-law are missionaries in South Africa right now with their children. And then you see my niece and my two nephews, because I don't have any little girls. So that's Gracie on my lap. And then Gabe and Gavin, my brother's kids. And then upstanding next to my father are my two sons, David and Jacob. And they're both out of high school, working. So those are my sons. And this was just this last Easter. But you know, family is really important, and God designed us to be in a relationship with one another. He designed for there to be a family, a network of people around you who love you. I know no matter what happens in my life, I can pick up the phone and call my dad, call my mom, my brother, and say, hey, can you pray for me right now? Or I just need words of encouragement. And they're gonna do that because that is the design that God had planned for us to be able to connect with one another, to be in a relationship, for that family unit to be intact. So when we go through life, we have people supporting us, okay? Now, I have a special relationship. Now, I want you to notice the hat my father's wearing. Maybe you can't make it out, but this is in his Dodger loving days. We were at Petco Park right there, and you can see me with my Padres hat and my jacket. My mom, she's trying to be neutral. She wore navy blue in support of me, but she's actually a Giants fan. We have a kind of conflicted family when it comes to baseball. My father has changed teams. He's back to being a Giants fan. But I'm not really sure. He's a flip-flopper, so we don't trust him there. But when it comes to anything else, I trust my dad. I absolutely trust him. We like to take trips together. There are things that we have done, just the two of us, that have really caused us to have a special relationship. And a lot of times when I think of the Father, the Heavenly Father's love, I relate a lot of that love that I've received to the experiences I've had with my own father. We like to golf a lot, so here's us all on the golf course. And you know, there's some stories I've told to the sixth graders about me and my dad, and I'm not gonna go into the Speedo story or a bunch of those, but I am gonna share one you already heard. My dad and I used to go backpacking a lot, and we would like to go backpacking, and we one time would go out for a week, and we took all these youth, teenagers from our youth group, and my dad and I decided when we got into there the third day that me and him were just gonna take a day hike, just by ourselves. And so we take this hike, and we're going down all these different trails, and we're going up this mountain, and it was hot, it was really hot. And we finally found a lake, and he went swimming, I didn't. And we needed to get back to camp. And we got to this one point, this one peak, where we could see our camp way down at the bottom. We saw the lake where we were camped out at. And the people there, our party with us, they looked like little ants. It was that high up. That's how small it looked. And we were trying to figure out, how are we gonna get from this peak down to where our camp is? We don't know which trail we took to get up there. And it was a little scary. So we finally figure, well, the closest way to get down is just to go straight down, so we're gonna do it. And we didn't realize the steepness of the mountain. So we start making our way down, and it just keeps getting steeper and steeper. And so at first we're kinda like just kinda all of a sudden angling like this to try to keep our balance, and I had to turn around and then scale down the side of this mountain. And it was getting scary. And my dad, he says, you know, we're gonna get through this, Rachel. It's okay, it's okay. We didn't have any harnesses, no gear. We weren't really prepared for this trip, looking back. And at one point, I'm scaling, and I was scared. My dad's like, I got you. And he says, but don't look at your right hand. What are you gonna do when someone says, don't look at your right hand? You're gonna look at your right hand, right? So I look at my hand, and there's like bugs and ants crawling all over it. I'd stuck my hand into like the home, the nest of some ants, and I'm like, ah, you know, and I'm shaking and I'm losing my balance, and my dad pushes me up against the face of the mountain, which was better than falling off. It hurt, but you know, he had my back, literally, he had my back. And you know, he really saved my life that day, because I could have fallen back and been toast. But my dad was there, and he had me when I needed him most. Those relationships are really important for us. You know, you have to feel supported. We have a safe community of people. And having that special trust relationship with my dad, where I knew I could put my life in his hands and be okay, that takes some guts. That takes vulnerability to trust someone. It's probably easier to do so with someone who's close in your family than it is to do with a complete stranger, right? Yeah? But there are often times where our lives are in other people's hands. There are things that happen to us that we can't control, and sometimes we need to be able to be vulnerable and trust. When we're starting to get to know someone, it takes some vulnerability to step out there and be a friend to someone you just met and to put yourself out there. But as you do that, that person gets to know you, you get to know them. That trust will build, okay? And when those trust relationships build, well then you're prepared to be able to call on that person when something doesn't quite go right. And there was a time in my life where, about a period of year and a half, a lot of difficult things happened. I was in seventh grade, and my grandfather passed away. He passed away of cancer. I saw him just before he died, and that was devastating to us. A couple months later, my uncle, who was like a second dad, he passed away, cancer as well. And these tragedies started happening, and I hadn't experienced death in my family before. And that was really tough to deal with, trying to understand, why, God, are these things happening? I still felt love from my father, you know, my earthly father. I still felt love from our family. We pulled together, but I was still asking all these questions, why? And then something really interesting happened. What is this? Electric blanket. Yeah, it's an electric blanket. All right, how many of you have electric blankets? All right, I'm never gonna sleep over at your house because you have an electric blanket. And I'll say this because I had an electric blanket that one morning, in the beginning of my eighth grade year, I did not turn off. At about 10 a.m., this thing started catching on fire. And my whole room was toast from an electric blanket. Now, my mom came home just around 10 when this thing started, and smoke was pouring out of the vents of the side of our house, and she was supposed to be leaving on a trip an hour beforehand with my dad to go to some conference up in Northern California. And she comes home, she's on the phone with someone, looks outside, sees smoke pouring, hangs up, calls 911, fire department comes. They were able to save the whole house except for my room. Everything was lost. Everything. The only thing I had after that were the clothes that I wore to school and what was in my backpack. Okay? So I'm coming home from school, walking home from junior high, and I see my dad at the end of the street where our house is, and he's just kind of standing there waiting for me. And I'm thinking, why is he here? They're supposed to be out of town. My Aunt Donna is supposed to be here with us. And he's waiting there, and actually right before then, I actually thought I was in trouble, because right before then I had kind of done, I was a little bit of a bully. Short man's disease, whatever you want to call it. I had a chip on my shoulder, and I had just thrown someone's backpack in a garbage can, like just a block away, because they had been teasing me about being short, so I grabbed the backpack and I threw it in the trash, and I was running home. I got around the corner, I see my dad, and I think, how'd he already catch me? How did I already get in trouble? So I'm walking up real timid and going up to my dad, and he just looks sad. And he says, Rachel, I want you to sit down on the curb. So I sit down, and I'm just ready to spill my guts and apologize. And he goes, I have some bad news. There was a fire, and everything in your room is gone. And my dad was a practical joker. He's always playing jokes on everyone. He was a youth pastor. Everyone was playing jokes. Our house was always getting TP'd. And I thought, well, this is a weird joke, but whatever, Dad, that's a great story. So I got up because I realized I'm not in trouble. So I get up and I start walking towards the house, and he goes, Rachel, I'm not kidding. Your room was really destroyed. And he says, let me show you something. He pulls me over to the side of the house, and on the side of the house is my bed. And it's mangled, it doesn't look like my bed anymore. And I went, wow, you've really gone to great lengths on a practical joke on me, Dad. I really thought he was joking. And I was like, Mom's gonna be so mad when she sees this trash on the side of our house, Dad. And so I just ignore him, and I go inside the house, and I'm walking down the hallway, and there's handprints, like glove prints from the firemen. And then I realize this isn't a joke anymore, and I go into my room, and everything is just black. Now, that's not a picture of my actual room. I found that on the internet, but it looked worse than this. Walls were completely black. The bed was already outside, but just it didn't even look like a room. And we got to spend the next month living in a hotel because they had to completely clean up our house. But to lose everything after losing two people I loved, it just was a real devastating point in my life. But I experienced a tremendous amount of love from my parents and from my dad. And just, you know, even though I felt like this was my fault that we had to move out of our house, it wasn't my fault, okay? But I learned some valuable lessons out of there, much like this electric blanket.
It's real easy for us to just continue to turn something on, to be plugged into the source, okay? And now I'll talk a little, like, plugged in the source of God, okay? When we're plugged in and we're going about our life, I grew up in a Christian home. I knew what truth was. I knew I was loved, and I was plugged in. But if I'm not checking myself on a regular basis, a blanket like this, just like my life, can have little flaws in it. Something can creep in. It can be well-worn. And if I'm not checking it on a regular basis, there can be a problem there that starts to grow, that eventually could start smoldering and catch on fire, even though I have the love of God living in me. Later on in life, I had some other things go on, and I want to share this staff I have. As an adult, I was a principal of a school down in Chula Vista, San Diego County, and I've been walking with the Lord since I was 6 years old. You know, I have my roller coaster moments, you know, but at this point in my life, I was almost 30 years old and running a school and seemed like on the prime. Everything was just going well. My kids are doing well. You know, my marriage was doing really well. And then something happened. Something happened that was devastating twice over. I was pregnant and I lost two babies. And sometimes life is taken from you. And sometimes tragedy happens you can't even explain, you know? And just more loss. And it reminded me when that happened, the loss I had when I was a little girl with my my uncle and my grandfather, the loss of my room. And I was just like, gosh, why do these things happen in life? Why do they have to happen? I'm trying my best to do so well, Lord. And I spent weeks just crying in my room, trying to understand one after another why these two children couldn't come to be. And I got back to school after about a month, and the students in the school presented me with this staff. And they took the time to put their fingerprints all over it. And one of the students made this, and then the significance of it was, you've touched the lives of people because God's touched your life. And so each one of them wanted to put their thumbprint on here and give this to me and said, you know what? You lead our school like we're your family, and we know that you love us. You're our shepherd. And it was in that moment that I just felt the love of God washing over me because those kids extended to me what I had extended to them before, which all came back from God's love. And it really talks about in Romans, if we look back a little further, Romans 28, 39, and we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. I know he loved me, and he was going to work these things to do miracles in the lives of those children because I was vulnerable and I shared with them, okay? And for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to his image of God, of his son. He wants you to be like his son. That's the plan. So that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. And these whom he predestined, he also called. Each one of you have been called. And those who he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. You guys are all glorified. And what then shall we say to these? If God is for us, who is against us? No matter what's going on in our lives, we can always stand on the fact that God is for us. And it doesn't matter what we're facing. It doesn't matter what's against us. He is always for us. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is he who died. Yes, rather who was raised and who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. And I love this part. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Just as is written, for your sake, we are being put to death. All day we were considered as sheep to be slaughtered. And then here's these verses again. But in all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. And now here's the cool thing. When you've accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, that love can never be separated from you. No matter what happens to you, no matter what you choose to do, it is always there. Nothing can separate it. Nothing. Close your eyes for just a moment. Each one of us may not have experienced death, but maybe we've experienced things where we feel like we failed. That thing that you're thinking about right now cannot ever separate you from the love of God. Just picture him wrapping his arms around you. That's all he wants to do is love on you. Lord, I just ask right now that you will just, you'll just love on us. And no matter what, we can give you glory. And I thank you, Lord, that your love is something that we can't even completely understand. We can't even wrap our minds around. But you want to love us, and you chose to love us, and you sent your son so we won't be separated from you, God. Help us to embrace that today. And just remember that we're your daughters, your sons. We are royalty. And that is exactly how you see us. You don't see our circumstances. You don't see our sin. You see your son in us. And we thank you for that. Help us to keep that in our mind and not let go of what you've given us, God. In your name, amen. I want to share with you one other thing, and then two of my buddies are going to come up and help me if you guys can make your way to the stage. My life verse is out of 1 Thessalonians 5:16 to 18. And it says, rejoice always. So no matter what, we are to rejoice. Can you just repeat that to me? Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. So never stop praying. And in everything, give thanks. Say, give thanks. And the last part there is because this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. All right. We're gonna do a special song. And this song really has to do with how sometimes we don't understand, but we still choose to love him. When we don't understand what's going on in our lives, we choose to love him. And how we do that is by breathing him into our lives each and every day. You wake up and you start breathing in the love of God. And when we're filled with his love, then that enables us to love other people. Because just like the slide says, without the love of God infusing our lives, it is impossible to truly love others. You want to love each other, then you've got to be filled with his love first. And then it's just going to naturally spill out onto other people. So this could be a new song for some of you, but what I'm asking is, sing along. Just try. And when we get to the chorus, I breathe you in, God. Okay, and it's another part's going to be like, you are good, God. You are good to me. Okay, so it's really simple, and we're going to give this a shot.
I love the opportunity for you guys to get to hear from the adults that you have working so that you know all of us are available to you. You've all heard, you keep hearing little bits of our stories. Believe it or not, we kind of have been where you are. And I know it seems like, wow, a long time ago. But we do remember. We do remember. So let us close and I'm going to release you to break and homeroom time. Well, let's go to the Lord first. Father God, thank you so much. Just for being a God that cares enough about us to be involved in every single story. That not one of us cannot be known by you. You already know us, whether we feel like it or not. Teach us how to understand and know you, God. And teach us how to feel known by you. And Lord, I just pray over each and every one of these students in this room, Lord Jesus, that you would bless them and that you would be working in their hearts so that they might know you. Thank you for them. Thank you for the privilege of having them at this school. In your precious name, amen.